are digital twins reshaping the defense industry? And how is Ansys driving innovation in this space? I'm Asma, Senior Product Marketing Manager at Ansys, and you're watching the Twin Talks. To answer these questions, I'm honored to be joined today by Brigadier General, retired Steve Bleymaier, Chief Technology Officer for Aerospace and Defense at Ansys, Regional Sales Manager at Ansys. Steve is leading innovation and strategic initiatives to advance simulation technologies in the aerospace and defense sectors. As a recognized thought leader in aerospace and defense, Steve is committed to pushing the boundaries of technology to support safer, more efficient, and more resilient aerospace and defense systems. Steve and Vitor, thanks for joining us today to discuss the critical role of digital twins in the defense industry.
Thank you, Asma.
Steve, it would be great if you could start by telling our Twin Talks audience a bit about yourself.
Yes, thank you. So before joining Ansys, I was in the U.S. Air Force for 28 years, and I was a Brigadier General on the aircraft maintenance sustainment side of the Air Force. And after retiring in 2019, I joined Ansys shortly after that. And for the first 2 years with Ansys, I was in sales in Federal Aerospace and Defense, and I led the sales team that called on the federal government at NASA, Department of Energy, and all of the Department of Defense. And for the last 3 years, I've worked for our corporate CTO as the CTO for Aerospace and Defense, helping our teams worldwide with their aerospace and defense customers.
Steve, what are the biggest challenges defense organizations face when adopting digital engineering technologies?
Well, that's a very complex question. The challenges are really multifaceted, and there isn't a software easy button. At Ansys, we held an aerospace and defense advisory panel day 2 years in a row with senior digital transformation leaders from the Department of Defense, each of the armed services, NASA, Department of Energy, and all of the major primes and many of their tier one suppliers. And the first year we met, we identified that the shift from traditional engineering or digital engineering from the current disconnected siloed state to a future state that's model-based, collaborative, agile, connected, traceable, DevSecOps, that vision that we want to achieve, it's not a destination, but it's rather a journey. And the goal is a state of perpetual agility, to be agile, to adapt to customer needs, and in the case of defense, to the changing threat. And there are many needs and challenges in four areas of people and culture, technology, processes, and infrastructure. And an organization has to attack all four equally from the top down and sustain those efforts as a long-term priority. And we know digital engineering requires a change management strategy, and that the application of digital engineering, of digital technologies, in engineering includes design, simulation, and optimization of systems and processes over the entire life cycle, and it encompasses all engineering disciplines. So it's about getting an organization to get to a point where they're thinking differently, working differently, and developing differently with an open ecosystem that's mission-centric and has a connected digital thread.
So Steve, can you talk about the role that Ansys plays in transforming the A&D sector?
Well, sure. There's an imperative for digital engineering, and it's driven by the increasing complexity of systems and the urgent demand to acquire them faster. You could say it's all about speed. But when we look at defense, with the changes occurring in the character of war due to the nature of some of the recent geopolitical conflicts that are ongoing, the need to defend against mass because of drone swarms, and the mandate in the U.S. Department of Defense for digital engineering and digital mission engineering for all new programs after December 2023, and then recent priorities of AI and autonomy and everything, plus the demand for adaptable by design and interoperability, the new deterrent of the industrial capacity of a nation to produce faster based on commercial technology, and to innovate faster than the adversary. All of these factors, the current context of aerospace and defense environment, they are driving the digital engineering transformation in A&D. So there's many factors. It's very complex. And Ansys has the technology today to help. because we're open architecture, well, we can connect to whatever legacy infrastructure an organization has, from commercial off the shelf to government off the shelf to in-house developed. And we can help build out a digital engineering environment that's connected and collaborative, starting at requirements and concept development with digital mission engineering to develop a design reference mission, to derive and evaluate requirements and iterate on requirements, and then to connect workflows and do trade-offs to get to optimization with multidisciplinary design analysis and optimization, and connect models-based system engineering requirements to analytical models, and then add fidelity to verify those design reference mission requirements with multi-physics simulations and digital twins, and then manage design and process workflows to integrate enterprise data, and then connect that to PLM and ALM, et cetera. So the bottom line is we help aerospace and defense customers to innovate faster, and by doing so, they reduce cost and schedule and increase availability and readiness.
And Vitor, the Digital Twin Consortium recently updated its definitions for a digital twin, emphasizing synchronization, data flow, and model-based approach. How do these refined definitions shape the way we approach digital engineering?
Hey, Asma, thank you for the question. And thank you again for the opportunity to speak here. It's actually interesting because that question and the context around it has a lot to do with what Steve just mentioned, right? There is a big, big shift, or at least a big update in the digital engineering process around defense. So to be more adoptive of such practices, hence the mandates, hence the instructions that the Department of Defense in the US has issued, and other governments are also following suit. Those also were brought into the Digital Twin Consortium. So the Digital Twin Consortium saw an opportunity. In the past, the consortium was very, very relevant in terms of dictating or at least postulating definitions, because there was a lot of confusion out in the field. What is a digital twin? What is not a digital twin? What is the value proposition? But as different technologies were put in place to fulfill that original definition that is about operations and maintenance and sustainment, those techniques, the consortium saw that they can be brought on early on to support the digital engineering practices that the defense applications are postulating now with the new mandates and instructions. And they saw an opportunity to look at twins as a spectrum where, yes, the digital twin is still in operations, is still in maintenance and sustaining, but the techniques that enable that can be brought on early on in designs and testing to move faster, like Steve was alluding. So that's the context of this change, right? Is, hey, not that the definition has necessarily changed its core, but there is an acknowledgement that there is a spectrum where the journey to get to a digital twin will provide additional milestones and value in a digital engineering context.
And Vitor, how do digital twins improve mission readiness, predictive maintenance, and overall system performance in defense applications?
It's a very good question, right? So obviously there will be different techniques, different applications, but thinking of it from a life cycle approach, and Steve already alluded to it, right? That whether if you have for past programs, data that you can leverage to build AI models, data-driven models, whether if there is enough simulation to characterize those systems, you can start bringing those early on to start verifying requirements. As you add more fidelity to the models, you start getting to a point where they represent the system at a higher fidelity, and you use those systems to now, those digital artifacts, to start validating requirements, to start getting test data back and being able to evaluate in a digital world, whereas if something that is happening in the real world meets a certain requirements or not. All of that streamlines the ability for programs to move when you're talking about new designs or modernization of designs, right? So that's the context of using the digital twin enabling techniques early on in design and testing. But then you also have the traditional area of bringing those models and simulations to bear in operations and sustaining settings, where now you're talking about understanding assets performance, understanding system operating ranges to maximize life, to minimize services, to enhance availability. So all of that are different applications that digital twin enables. Now, what we're seeing is what early on was value proposition primarily for operations and sustainment. Now you see value proposition being brought earlier on to the designers and the testers as well.
And can you share a real world example where a simulation made a significant impact on defense operations or asset management?
Yeah, I think the one of the main aspects that I see that I can talk with some level of confidentiality is around modernization programs, right? Sometimes modernization programs have some level of test or operational data. So these are programs of systems that have been in place for some time. They were developed way back when. Sometimes they have some level of modeling simulation, sometimes they don't. So there's a spectrum. And then at the same time, there are lots of data or some level of data available, and the fusion of the two, right? The combination of taking operational test data and modeling and simulation data with different levels of availability and readiness has enabled programs to get to a level of understanding on the system in a digital world that was not there before. Because the challenge with modernization program is sometimes you have a lot of data, operational data, but you only have it in specific locations for specific variables that limits your understanding of the system. Similarly, sometimes the modeling and simulation that was done decades ago was not as sophisticated as today. So there is also a limited understanding about the system. What we saw with the few applications that we got engaged with the Department of Defense so far is the combination of the two worlds in a hybrid modeling context has augmented the ability to understand the system performance and dictate a way to operate it more efficiently or to even modernize it appropriately or understand if the modernization strategy will be a success. All of that has been enabled by the combination of the two, which is one of the pillars of the modern digital twin applications today, right? The concept of hybrid digital twins.
Steve and Vitor, what innovations or advancement do you see shaping the future of digital twins in the defense industry?
Well, I'll go first, thanks. So the good news is in many of the new system requirements that governments are giving to suppliers, they include the requirement to build digital twins for every asset. So for new weapon systems, that's good news. You know, it's much easier to build digital twins on the front end during design and testing. And so the expectation is that condition-based maintenance will be seamless for these new systems, making preventive maintenance more extensive and efficient, changing parts before they fail at the time and place of an organization's choosing, which minimizes disruptions to the mission, reduces the supply chain, and especially the cost of replacement parts because you need fewer parts in fewer locations. But the biggest impact will be to readiness. The availability and reliability of systems will increase. For legacy systems or systems that are already fielded without digital twins or even without digital anything, which is a majority of systems, that creates a bigger engineering challenge, but it's possible. You know, when you use a hybrid digital twin and fuse existing data analytics, maintenance information that's been data cleansed and uses AI, physical sensors that trip algorithms, et cetera, and you fuse that data, that information with real-time physics based on digital twins that use real-time data from either physical or virtual sensors, that fusion brings the confidence level of predicting failure to 98% from around 80% with just using data analytics and AI.
How about you, Vitor?
Yeah. Building up on what Steve just mentioned, right? I like to bring back the concept of the life cycle there. The it's less about now just the digital twins, I would say, in defense. It's more about the digital twins in the context of the whole digital engineering, the whole life cycle, right? So as digital twins become available for new systems, like Steve has mentioned, there is the ability now to connect these digital twins for different parts of the systems together, whether if you have different suppliers, different tiers, different primes, the government, there is an idea now that these artifacts will be shared in an interoperable way such that you can validate requirements and verify requirements. I think this is going to streamline a lot more the design process there, the testing process, and the enablement of these technologies to be out in the field faster. Now, at the same time, in operations, you will see also the concept of hybrid digital twins from an adaptability standpoint. So as the systems age, you will see the ability of data being in the field gathered, updating these digital twins, updating these digital models, such that they maintain the levels of fidelity that Steve just talked at 98%, not just in the first day of the mission or the third or the 100th day of the mission, but 2-3 years down the road, because the twins will keep self-adjusting based on some of the techniques that are coming out there. So those are two things that I believe that will make a big difference in the upcoming years in defense there, complementary to what Steve already just mentioned.
And that's perfect, Vitor. And I'd like to add one more aspect, and that is that by using these digital twins that are digital artifacts that were produced at different parts of the life cycle, they are connected to a digital thread that goes all the way back to the original authoritative source of truth, that first design reference mission. And so when upgrades need to happen, it should happen much faster than it does today, and with much less disruption and much less cost, because you've maintained that connection back to that authoritative source of the truth, and you have those digital twins from as designed to as tested to as manufactured, as operated, and as maintained, and that allows you to go faster at less cost.
Thank you both for joining me today. It's been an insightful conversation, and I know our audience will take away a lot from your perspectives.